He was then imprisoned in the Tower of London and finally beheaded on Tower Hill on the 6th of July, 1535. Moore died with great courage and calmness, and his execution shocked all Europe. He was made a saint by the Roman Catholic Church in 1935.
Welcome to St. Dunstan's Canterbury. For 1,000 years now, St. Dunstan's has been welcoming pilgrims to this church. Indeed, it was in 1174 that King Henry II stopped off here to change his clothes, to do penance following the murder of Thomas Becket. The other remarkable date is 1535, because that was when Thomas More was beheaded in the Tower of London. His daughter, Margaret, rescued his head, and when it came for her to be buried, her father's head was buried here beside her. Thomas More himself expected to have been buried in the tomb and in the grave that he had prepared for his wife in Chelsea Old Town Church. We're standing on the outside of the chapel that Roper created for his family where they were to be buried. Pilgrims from all over the world come now to this church, principally because of the head of Thomas More, and it is our joy to welcome them at every possible opportunity and occasion. Pilgrims now from all over the world come to this church. They're drawn here by this man for all seasons. After some years of negotiation, we were able to obtain a faculty to open the vault so that we could actually go down there and photograph it and record it, videos and other cameras, so that pilgrims who usually cannot approach the head of Thomas More will get a closer view. We're standing here in the vault, the Roper vault, very close to the centre of pilgrimage, because here behind the grill is a leaden casket. Over a long period of time, someone has
pushed a hole in the casket, and there, just inside, are the very much deteriorated remains of Thomas More's skull. Not much remains, because this part was above the earth, and therefore the air has got to it over these few hundred years. In fact, even though we read that Margaret Roper kept the head in spices until her death, it's quite clear that the skull would have had a lot to make it deteriorate over a long period of time.
We were fortunate enough to have Tim Tatton-Brown, the archaeologist, who came down and gave us a talk and some instruction on the value and the archaeological aspect of Thomas More's head.
Now, some of you may well say, well, why open up the vaults? Why do this? It's essentially so that it can be recorded in a way that can suit the pilgrims who come to this church. Anyone who's here for a short period of time knows only too well that the church is always open for pilgrims, and the great reason for their coming is because of Thomas More. And I've seen the look of disappointment so often when they see only a slab commemorating the fact that his head is buried. Now, it will never be open for ordinary pilgrims as they come, because it's a burial place and it's a place of security. But it is important that we are at least able to give them some sort of photograph or postcard, which we shall have made, and if necessary, a video of an explanation of what is down below the altar when we celebrate almost every day or every other day, just above the tombs. So you see, it's an act of worship, it's an act of pilgrimage, it's also an act of information, so that our pilgrimage and our worship should be as informed as possible. And that's why we're particularly glad that Tim Tatton-Brown has come all the way from Salisbury, leading a very, very busy life, has made time to come and speak to you about the vault. It's particularly valuable that it should be Tim Tatton-Brown, because he was the one 19 years ago who spearheaded the recovery of the vault when it was simply filled with rubble and dirt and dust. You will find it's lovely down there. There's a lovely atmosphere. Even from the moment that the stones were taken back, it's sweet, and it really is prayerful down there, and it's not at all a frightening place. And I'm so glad to have seen it, because having now seen it, I understand much, much more, and I know I'm going to understand even more in a moment when Tim's spoken.
Well, good evening. It's a pleasure to be back in Canterbury. I lived here for very many years, and I've now lived in Salisbury for only 4.5 years. So I've lived in Canterbury much longer than Salisbury, and it's great to come back to this church, which I used to know very well indeed, not least that I lived only just down the road. The heart of the story is the Roper family, by far the most important family to have lived in this parish. Sadly, there aren't any Ropers, I don't think, certainly no descendants in the parish now, but for half a century at least, if not more, the Ropers were the most prominent family in the parish, and it's because of them that Thomas More's head is here. And one of the most important things, the only real discovery I suppose I can claim to make, and it was only a discovery in the sense that I put two and two together and made four, was suddenly realizing that the record of the inscription on one of the tombs here, which is long gone, but the record made by William Sumner, the great 17th century historian of Canterbury, had not been fully understood or assimilated by the Thomas More scholars. And this is extremely important because it relates to where Margaret More, who then became Margaret Roper when she married William, where she was buried. And that is one of the critical parts of the story, which I'll say something about in a minute. The beginning of the 16th century, who perhaps reached the highest level, that was the father of William, who married Margaret More, and he was the Attorney General. So he was basically, well, Cabinet Minister, we still have an Attorney General today, but a very important lawyer, and very much involved in the national scene. And of course it was because of him being at court, Henry VIII's court, before that Henry VII's court, that the family met the family of Thomas More, and obviously that was when his son, William, who wasn't nearly as important a lawyer as his father, met and then married Margaret More. So that's how the two strands come together. Now, it was the second of these John Ropers, who died in 1524, who was responsible for the building, the Chantry Chapel, in its present form. And it is almost certainly his tomb that is the tomb on the right-hand side at the end there. There are two tombs, and the problem is that both of them had bronze inscriptions on them, which have completely disappeared. But if you look carefully at the back wall of the first of the tombs, the one that I say must almost certainly be John Roper's tomb, you will see the trace of the indent of two kneeling figures, John Roper and his wife Jane, and coming out of their mouths are sort of great scrolls which would have had something written on them. This is very common for this period, the late 15th, early 16th century. First of all, it is well known that after Thomas More's execution, his head, of course, was displayed in the barbaric way of the time on a pole on London Bridge. And there's the well-known story of how Margaret retrieved the head, which must be true. There can be little doubt about that. It would never have been made up. And almost certainly what she did was to have it embalmed and kept in a casket, and the remains of the core of that casket, the lead casket in which it was kept, you will be able to see down in the vault behind the little grill. I'll say a little bit more about the details there in a minute. But she no doubt carried it around. It sounds a strange thing to do today. But during the rest of her lifetime, and of course it was a difficult job even retrieving the head of a traitor from London Bridge, from the end of the southern end of London Bridge, but then being able to carry it around with her for the rest of her life. And that's another important thing. That's why it is here, why it is not, say, in Chelsea Old Church. No doubt, I think it would have been buried with her in Chelsea Old Church in 1544, before, as I've just said, being brought here with when her husband eventually died a long time after, in 1577, for reburial here. And that's how one can link that together. So it was John then who started built the new Chantry Chapel, made his burying place there and made that monument. And then his son, William, as I've already said, who married Thomas More's daughter, who had this second tomb made. And that we can do the same here, as I'll say in a minute. You see here, this is the last of the major Roper monuments. This, by the way, was originally in the chapel, was only moved into the chancel in the late 19th century. You're immediately into a classical monument. The contrast between this, which dates from the end of the 16th century, typical of the later 16th century and subsequently, is totally classical. Only at the end of the 16th century was the actual burial vault that you see now actually made. And if you go into it, as I say, you just go down some steps, you'll find it is a rectangular north-south space with a barrel vault over the top in this direction. But if you look carefully, as I've already mentioned, the southern end, you can see at the top the earlier brickwork, and then very prominent scars on the side walls showing where the later brickwork joins it, and also a slightly different bit of brick barrel vault immediately under the tomb itself. That's the early original slot, And clearly what was done at the end of the 16th century was that the family decided that now was the time to have a proper burial vault for a family vault. The actual coffins must have been lifted out from under those two tombs, the end of the 16th century, put on one side, a large hole was dug in the floor there, and this burial vault was then actually built. And this is where the evidence isn't very clear, the coffins, I think, were probably put down, that's the coffins of John and Jane Roper, and of William and Margaret, were then probably put down into this new burial vault. So that I think they were put there, and it was probably at that time that the niche in the wall on this north side, which you'll see on your left when you go down there, a little small hole was cut in the wall, and a slot was made in which to put the lead casket containing the head of Thomas More.
You see, that says Charles Henshaw Esquire married Elizabeth, only daughter of Edward Roper Esquire of Well Hall in the county of Kent. Died July the 1st, 1726, age 63.
Oh, yes.
And they're quite focused, they're all in different styles, you see. That one, the lettering is much more square. That's good 18th century hand.
This one?
Later 18th century or something. And they, unfortunately, they're all here rather than as on originally. Each one would have been on a different coffin.
She's another 80-year-old.
Yes, you're wonderful.
It was lovely. Well done.
Lovely to have seen you.
Yes.
I wouldn't have missed it.
St. Thomas More's trial took place on July the 1st, 1535. More was sentenced to the traitor's death, to be drawn, hanged and quartered, which the king changed to beheading. He walked to the scaffold on Tower Hill. "See me safe up," he said to the lieutenant, "and for my coming down let me shift for myself." He told the onlookers to witness that he was dying, in the faith and for the faith of the Catholic Church, the king's good servant, but God's first.